And welcome to We're on the Pier, and guess who's here with me, Yael Breuer. Just on the other side of the pier, there's the West Pier. I know it's a little bit skeleton, but it's still beautiful, as we're going to see.
Our West Pier is a skeleton of a pier, we know that, but it is still beautiful, and it's particularly beautiful when we look at the work of Alleges. Did I pronounce your name correctly?
Yes, that's correct. Alleges, shortened from Alejandro Martinez.
Alejandro Martinez, I like that.
Yeah, but it's a very long name, very common. To make it unique.
That's fine. So, Alleges, you're an artist, but you're also an architect. The two are not that different from each other. And you have an exhibition at the West Pier Centre that's running from now until January. Tell me a little bit about the pictures. I haven't yet been, but I looked it online and I wasn't sure if they were photos or drawings, or and it's a sort of combination of a few things. So tell me.
Well, they are called digital pigment prints. From my ink drawings that I do with fineliner, 005 point, very, very detailed, very, very precise. I scan them and color is added digital, and then I produce the print. This is the same process that I do when I do presentations for my clients in architecture.
Right. So I like that you use the same technique with your clients, and that inspired you to be creative and produce an exhibition of art, really.
Correct. Often my clients, they ask me if they could have my line drawings to have them framed.
Right, yes.
Because they find them very beautiful.
Right.
But somehow, line drawings, black and white, they're not. We have to add some color to it to make them more readable, accessible, more vibrant. And that's what led me to produce these images.
Right. And the exhibition at the West Pier Centre, are the pictures only of the West Pier or a variety of things?
I would say 50-50. I love the West Pier. It's always fascinated me, and I've drawn it many, many times. And the structure of steel is something that appeals a lot to me as an architect. But there are also landscapes of Brighton, landscapes of the countryside, Devil's Dyke, Glynde, and other views, and some of London. So it's landscapes and architectural elements.
And a real variety.
Yeah.
So where do people find the West Pier Centre? It's just by the I-360, right?
Yes, it's on the east side. It's under the West Pier arches.
Right.
So it's one of them.
So just the arches under the West Pier.
And it'll be open. My exhibition will run until January. And it's open Friday to Mondays, 11 in the morning till 5 p.m.
Great. And if people want to look up at your work online, where do they find it?
Yeah, www.alleges.com. So that's where I am.
Great. I'm looking forward to going and check it out for myself.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
If you're a dad and you want to join a sort of dad's army, I've got the right man for you. Dan, hello.
Hello, that's a lovely way of putting it.
So you're the founder of an organisation that's there for dads and their children.
Yeah, it's the organisation is called Dadless Soul. We're a non-profit based over in Worthing. We're a sort of grassroots revolutionary movement that uses arts, technology and music to battle social isolation. It's kind of hard as a middle-aged man to put your hand up and go, you know, I want some friends. Your social life gets a lot smaller, and you know, you can go to mother and baby groups, but you can't really engage. So about 2 years ago I had the idea to do something. So for the dads that wander around the park on a Saturday on their own or go to soft play and they're on their mobiles.
Right.
We do everything from filmmaking, DJ workshops, robot building. And we just barred all the mums, so it's a lot more fun.
Right, so it's a lot more fun without the mum. I mean, it is true that if you look for a mum, mother and toddler group, you go online, you'll find thousands of them.
Absolutely, try it with dads, and you'll have occasionally, you know, maybe a sing and sign group, which is great if a baby's really tiny, but hands up, how many of us actually want to do the wheels on the bus every single week?
Right. You can get quite into it.
Yeah, okay. Also, you know, we play drum and bass or the Stone Roses and stuff like that, so the dads can spark a conversation, because it can be quite lonely.
Right.
So it gives a chance for the kids to make some new friends, gives a chance for the dads to learn some new skills. So one of our dads was a film director, came in and showed us how to make films on our mobile phones. So next time it's a rainy Sunday afternoon, rather than putting the kids in front of the TV, I go, right, you're in charge of wardrobe, you're in charge of storyboarding, and you make something.
Right.
When we open up, we're operational in Worthing, we open up beginning of the year at Hurstpier Point, and we launch Brighton on the 19th. We've got Audio Active coming down.
Good old Audio Active.
Beautiful people, beautiful people. So we're going to do a beat making session and a dads versus kids rap battle.
Sounds good. So let's talk about the Brighton one. Yep. Where are you?
That's on the 19th, Saturday the 19th at Limited One. That's a platform which was Hove Town Hall. So it's now this award-winning, very, very cool sort of co-working space. So I went there for a meeting a few months ago and fell in love with the spot. And I thought, do you remember when you were a kid and go to work with your dad? And right. It was always very exciting, but also a bit boring. Now we can, but it's got, you know, 50-foot screens and state-of-the-art sound system and great coffee.
Great. So it's for dads and their children, yep. Aged from...
From about 0 to about 10. Anything older than that, the kids are becoming teenagers and don't really want to hang out with the younger ones. But we've had dads, you know, come with their newborns strapped on that just want a coffee and have a chat and put their hands up, you know, what it's like to get used to having sleepless nights because you're doing the feed.
Right.
Right the way through to dads that have got 18-year-olds, but now I've got their second coming with right. Their other kids.
Oh, I think that's a great idea. So dadlasoul.
Dadlasoul.com.
How do people find about it?
Dadlasoul.com. You can come onto Facebook where we've got a private Facebook group, which is for the dads. So yeah, we do a lot of fun. We have a great time. But there's a very serious message that we're trying to battle, which is the social isolation. You know, you commute all week. And, you know, you can be quite stressful thinking that you've missed sports day again because, you know, you can't get out of work or maybe don't see your kids very often.
So with you, there's a whole variety in a safe environment.
Safe space.
Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you for having me. Cheers.
Zai and Dane from London are visiting the pier today. And you chose one of the best days to come here.
Luck. That's pure luck to come
pure
and
luck.
Have it still be warm.
Yes, absolutely. So tell me, what brought you to Brighton today from London?
It's a nice break away.
Uh-huh.
It's nice to get out of the city for a while and just come and relax.
Right.
And get the fish and chips while we're here as well.
Of course, that goes without saying. And what do you think about Brighton? Have you been before?
Been before, years ago. Lovely to come back. It's great to spend some time together.
Uh-huh. And what else have you been doing in Brighton?
So far, just been eating.
It's a good place.
I'm going to get some donuts in a minute as well.
Right. Right. Have you been on any rides, or are you?
Nah.
No rides of yet.
We're any still
just taking
to?
It all in. We may do.
Right.
We
yeah.
may
Thinking
do.
About it.
Right. Yeah, we actually may do.
I can't do it anymore. I used to love them, but now it's just...
Yeah, I look at them like, oh, I don't know about that one. I don't know.
Right.
What was your favourite ride?
My favourite ride was the scariest, the better. At the time. I'm talking about many, many years ago, though. And what would you say is your favourite bit so far about today?
The weather.
Yes, I was going to say, the weather.
The weather and the scenery, 100%.
Great. Lovely. Well, have a fantastic rest of day. Thank
you. And you too, yeah. Okay. Thank you very much.
MJ from Seattle is visiting Brighton. Hello, MJ.
Hi.
Hi.
Thanks for interviewing me.
Oh, no, yeah. Pleasure. Yeah. So tell me, why are you here in the first place? Are you just on holiday?
Yes, I am. I'm vacationing for 2 weeks in the UK. It's my first time out of the US, so.
Oh, wow, first time out of the US.
Yeah.
So what do you think about England so far?
Oh, it's been great. It kind of supports my spontaneous nature. There's so many things to do. I've been to the theater. I've come out here to the pier. I went to Stonehenge the other day. I've just been kind of getting a sample of the whole country, or just this portion of it at least.
Right.
Yeah.
That sounds like you've done quite a lot.
Yeah.
And what do you think of the pier? You have something similar in Seattle?
Yeah, we have a waterfront. Seattle is like on the Puget Sound, similar to here, the English Channel, I'm presuming. And it just brings a lot of home to me right now. So.
But it doesn't make you homesick, does it?
No, not at all. It's just it kind of elevates it. Yeah, yeah.
Right. And how does Seattle compare with Brighton as a whole? My experience with Seattle is only from Sleepless in Seattle, I'm
right.
afraid. So, what's the atmosphere, people? Any similarities?
I feel like it's more easygoing here, and the architecture is beautiful. Like I walked past the dome, getting off the train, I was floored.
Oh, that's nice to hear.
Yeah. Yeah.
Great. And so what are the plans for the next few days?
I actually go to Paris tomorrow.
Wow.
Yeah, and then I leave Monday. So what a lovely impact, yeah.
Lovely holiday, yeah. First time outside the USA as well, yeah. And the weather has been amazing.
Today it was great, yeah. Right. It's great.
Well, lovely to meet you. Enjoy the rest of your holiday. You. And that's the end of the first half. Don't forget to join us after the break. The bottom lines, they make me feel so free. Welcome back to We're on the Pier, and guess who's here with me, Yael Broya. We're going to dedicate the second half of the program to the artist Arnold Degani, who lived in Hove not that long ago.
Arnold Degani was an artist and a Holocaust survivor who lived in Brighton, and his niece is with me. Hello, Nadia Lassison.
Hello.
Welcome to Brighton. Brighton is obviously not a new place for you because you used to come and visit your uncle and your own parents here.
That's right. We spent much of our childhood and my children's childhood here in Brighton. Right. And actually it was Hove.
Right, yes.
Palmyra Square. They
Palmyra, the, number one Palmyra,
yes,
Square.
That's right.
Right, which
beautiful.
Is no longer the home of the family.
No.
But Degani lived there for quite a while, right? He came in the late 50s and lived
7 years, 1978 to 85.
To 85 when he died. Mm. Okay. And tell me a little bit about Degani. I have a book here with his work. It's very prolific and quite diverse. Artist, not as well known perhaps as he should be, and in fact we're hoping to...
He was his own worst enemy because he never wanted to sell. He painted like mad. He just never stopped. And that's the trouble. He even painted furniture, painted the bathroom, the wash basin, the toilet, the bidet, the bath, the tiles everywhere, everything. And any scrap of paper he'd find or a bit of cloth, he would paint.
And why didn't he want to sell?
Well, he thought that nobody could value his work enough. He thought he was in the same league as Picasso, which he was not quite. He is very great, but there's no one style that he didn't go through periods, if you like. He just painted what went into his mind, and he was a little bit crazy after coming out of the concentration camp. Right. And the fact that he survived was miraculous, but that was his illness, that he couldn't stop painting as a result of it. And so there's no one style. It's very, very diffuse.
And that probably kept him going. I mean, the creativity and not stopping.
Right.
A lot of his work is actually around. I mean, the Keep, just that belongs to Sussex University,
yes.
Has...
The Holocaust Museum. They have got many of his Holocaust paintings. And there was an exhibition at the Benoit. I think there are a few paintings in the Imperial War Museum, and right. I've got some. And then there are his massive diaries, which are huge books, like four times the size of this per page.
Right, right. And I know that Bill Smith from Latest TV is a very keen to create something here in Brighton that would bring the recognition of Degani.
I'm hoping Bill's going to make a wonderful documentary all about his life and his work.
Great. And another person that brought him to and his work to life was your own father.
That's right.
Do you want to tell me a bit about that?
My father was Miron Grindir, the editor of Adam International Review. He started his magazine as a young boy in Romania.
Right.
The first few copies are in Romania, and then he brought it here. And continued it to his dying day, and nobody's taken it on. It was so much a part of him that nobody could emulate his work. And issues, he had no money. He literally could only print one issue if he had advertising from British Airways or whatever. And so that was the issue of the time, and then the next one could only be published when he had more money. He was not very good at his subscribers and his list and the mailing. That didn't interest him. His excitement was discovering new articles and new writers or old writers and creating. He even found an existing relative of Charles Dickens, who had an unpublished article by the great man. And that was when he went to the heart of the English countryside to meet this distant relative with the article and then published it. And that was his great joy. Wow. And he published Dagani's diary, which is called The Grave is in the Cherry Orchard.
Right, which is out of...
Oh, it's totally out of print.
Right.
And I would love to see it be reprinted.
Well, let's hope we can help Dagani somehow.
Yes, I'm very excited at having met you all.
Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you. Bye.
Monica Bone Duchin is an art historian and she's here to talk to me about a special festival. Hello. Hello. Insiders, Outsiders Festival. What is it about?
Yes, indeed. It's a nationwide arts festival that officially began in March of this year and officially ends in March 2020, although I suspect it will go on beyond that because of the great amount of interest it's aroused. But essentially, it's a festival that straddles all the arts, that pays tribute to the extraordinary contribution that those who fled to this country from Nazi-dominated Europe made to this country's culture.
So in all aspects?
In all aspects of the arts. There's a sort of nod at other disciplines, but essentially it's an arts festival that is trying to make people now both understand the nature of that contribution, but also how relevant it is to the present day with all the debates about, well, dare I say it, you know, Brexit, but immigration, the status of refugees, the way we do or don't receive them properly. It's all very, very topical, and it's a reminder, I think, in the most general sense of how great a contribution that refugees have always made, continue to make, to any, you know, to their adopted
Okay,
countries.
I mean, in a separate interview, I just spoke to the niece of artist Arnold Dagani, who lived in Brighton for seven or so years, and he was a Holocaust survivor whose art very much reflected his experience. I think what you said about it being topical and relevant is particularly poignant because, you know, the Holocaust is something that's getting further and further, you know, in terms of time span, and young people, you know, are perhaps not as aware of things that that previous generations were aware. So how are you doing it? What is the festival promoting, if you like? What kind of exhibitions come under the umbrella of Insiders Outsiders?
Well, if I can just sort of answer that sort of, or go back to what you said just a few minutes ago. And there is, of course, a difference between those individuals who, in fact, were greater than in number than those who came after 1945, who came just in time. They are survivors, certainly in a very real sense. They were refugees. The British government, sometimes reluctantly, took them in, but they escaped the worst of it.
Right.
So it's a story of achievement, but against a very dark backdrop of loss, trauma, uprooting, etc. And indeed, the Holocaust is at its very core. Arnold Dagani, about whom I wrote this book some years ago, although I never had the honour of meeting him, is a member of that smaller group, those who did endure the worst. They came out the other end against all the odds, and they ended up in this country. So theirs is a slightly different story, but
right.
Of course it's all related. But what you say about the danger of the Holocaust receding into the mists of history is absolutely right. And it's through, above all, you know, real, you know, artistically rich achievements in all art forms, but also the individual stories that are both unique and also have a great deal in common one with the other, where the history is brought to life for a younger generation. I think that's really important. It's not didactic, but it does it, you know, sort of indirectly in a sense through the works themselves and the life stories.
So events are happening all over and for a year, which is incredible. Must have been
a big job.
A big job.
Yeah.
Some things are happening locally in Brighton and in Sussex.
Absolutely. Yes, indeed. There's a lot going on in this part of the world. And the one I should mention first, perhaps, is at Hove Museum and Art Gallery. It's an exhibition of the work of somebody who came as a refugee, was incidentally deported to Canada. This is a story of the British government deporting so-called enemy aliens, which is another story that far too few people know about. Eventually, he comes back to this part of the world and settles, I think, actually, in Hampshire. Friedrich Nagel is his name, completely self-taught, a kind of outsider artist who produced these haunting, often very miniature sculptures using found objects, materials, non-art materials, and that's just been extended, in fact, till early November. So that is certainly at Hove Museum, absolutely. So that's one to look out for. The other two that are on at the moment until I think early October October are at Pallant House Gallery in Chichester, an exhibition of the watercolours of a woman called Greta Marx, who was best known as a ceramicist. She studied at the Bauhaus, and this year, of course, is the centenary of that extraordinary, important teaching institution in Germany. But many of the Bauhaus teachers and students come to this country, and most people don't know that. Anyway, it's an exhibition of her work, watercolours and a few ceramics. She ends up not in Sussex, but I think in Stoke-on-Trent, working right. for the potteries there. And the other one is an exhibition of the work of Walter Nessler, who is actually, unlike most of the refugees, of course, and the survivors, not a Jew, but he was an anti-fascist who decided he couldn't abide staying in Nazi Germany, and he comes to this country.
Right, okay. And so the festival is officially finishing in March next year.
Yes.
As you say that there's been greater demand for various exhibitions, and
it's been a very rich cultural terrain to kind of tap into, and there's an awful lot happening, you know, in the next 6 months. We've still got 6 months to run, and the place incidentally to go to for information is the website, which is insidersoutsidersfestival.org, so that's the place to check exactly what's going on. But we're now thinking about a longer term legacy, both in terms of educational programs, but also perhaps an annual mini festival, some way of, you know, of kind of keeping the subject in the public eye, but also importantly, I think, encouraging other immigrant groups perhaps to take on board the idea of the festival and adapt it to their own particular purpose, if you like.
Great, so, and I'm sure in Brighton there will be, or already has been, good reception for the idea. And as we mentioned, Dagani, who lived in Brighton, in Hove rather, is something that we're hoping to bring more to the fore.
Absolutely, he's undeservedly neglected. It'd be wonderful to see him brought into the public eye. Yes, indeed.
Monica, thank you so much for coming to the studio.
It's a pleasure.
And that's the end of tonight's programme. Don't forget to join us every night at 8:30 p.m.